Hi, welcome back to me talking about Harry Potter fanfiction. On today's episode, we have... Does Taylor Swift ship Wolfstar? So, All the Young Dudes is a 500,000 word Marauder's era Harry Potter fanfiction from the point of view of Remus Lupin, and it goes from his first year in 1971 to the events just before Order of the Phoenix in 1995. Named for David Bowie's song All the Young Dudes, which I will never be able to listen to again, by the way, without having an emotional breakdown, by a writer with the screen name Miss King Bean 89. It was first posted in 2017 and it currently has over 950,000 hits and nearly 23,000 kudos. I don't know how into fanfiction and AO3 you are, but that's a lot. Like, a lot. That is the most of any fanfiction I have ever read. And I have read quite a few fanfictions. So, it's recently gotten a lot of attention because of TikTok. It has an entire fandom on there. I am queer and a Harry... Fuck off! Did you see that? JK Rowling is homophobic. She didn't like me saying the word queer because she's a TERF. That was homophobic of her. Maybe transphobic. It was definitely bigoted. Anyway, I'm queer and I'm a Harry Potter fan. So when I got TikTok, the algorithm naturally sent me towards Marauder's TikTok because that is the gayest of the Harry Potter eras. Like, four boys at boarding school who are so close that most other people think it's a bit weird. That's some gay shit. I'm dressed, for the occasion, I am dressed as 1970s Lily Evans. We're gonna pretend that these robes are Gryffindor robes, but I have a little, like, college council badge. I was on college council. I wasn't head girl because I was mentally ill. But Lily, we will pretend this says head girl. This is a little pin that says witches do it better. And then we have gold DV, because I did do gold DV even though I was mentally ill. And I got to go to Buckingham Palace. I feel like Lily Evans would have done gold DV. And also I have this little stag for James, to represent James. All the Young Dudes is technically a Wolfstar fanfiction in that Remus and Sirius do get together and they are the soulmates that they really quite obviously are, but it is mostly about their kind of adventures during Hogwarts and the first Wizarding War. The Marauders are in that sweet spot where we know enough about them as to find them interesting. Their characters or their characterizations and their stories are really interesting, but JK Rowling hasn't gotten in there with her grubby little transphobic plans and ruined everything, so fans can just kind of go in, do whatever they want with the characters, which I think is beautiful. And it definitely came off as beautiful and really fucking sad, tragic, emotionally devastating in All the Young Dudes. But what does any of this have to do with Taylor Swift? Well, spoilers for All the Young Dudes, by the way. I mean, you kind of already know what happens at the end, and I've also already said that it's Wolfstar. As I said, All the Young Dudes has its own little fandom on TikTok, and it's not even that small. Like, I'm not sure if it's small, but it's it takes up a lot of my feed at the minute. So on the 17th of January 2021, TikTok user Cunny01, or @CCUNNI01, made a TikTok about all the young dudes, as you do. You should follow them. Their entire feed is mostly about all the young dudes. On that video, they received a comment from another TikTok user called at Maddie Bubior, MaddieBaure, saying, I think Miss King being 89 is Taylor Swift, and I will not be taking criticism on this theory. And listen, she says she's not taking criticism, and I'm not here to criticise. I actually 100% agree with her. I just want to discuss both sides of the argument. Let's have a look at the evidence. First, and probably most convincing, Taylor Swift was born in 1989. The author is called Miss King Bean, 1989. We know that Taylor Swift has a big thing about numbers. On most of her accounts, she has the number 13 after her name, but she obviously can't do that if she's trying to like hide. So what's the next best number? Her birth year. After which she named her fifth studio album, 1989. And speaking of 1989, Taylor said that her music from that album was inspired by the music from the decade of her birth. Although All the Young Dudes is set mostly in the 1970s, it does go into the 1980s and have a few 1980s kind of like song references in there. Most of the song references are 1970s though, like David Bowie, T-Rex. But Taylor Swift is a musician, and anything she writes is obviously going to have a lot of musical influence to it. I mean, she's into 80s music. What is stopping her from being into 70s music, you know? After 1989, Taylor took a long break. She had previously in her career released an album every 2 years, but she took a longer break after 1989, from 2014 to 2017, after which she released Reputation. This is definitely enough of a break to write a fanfiction. For some people. For me, I have projects that I have been working on for longer than 3 years and I'm still not finished, but you know, a better writer than me, such as Miss King Bean, might be able to do it, or Taylor Swift, you know? Taylor definitely could have written the fanfiction during her break and then just kind of uploaded it chapter by chapter from 2017 to 2018 until it was done. But even if she didn't do this, she released two albums in 2020. We know that she has the ability to write quickly. So I feel like, I mean, even if she didn't do that, that is still not disproving the theory, you know? And we also know that she has the ability to write well. Not just lyrics, but poems and prose. Like the openings of her album, she always has like a nice little paragraph or a couple of paragraphs about how much she loves the fans and how much she loves the music. And her 1989 tour clean speeches, where she would just tell everyone how amazing and worth it they are. All the Young Dudes is written beautifully, and we know that Taylor is definitely up to that standard. All of her fans are constantly on at her to write a book, but they don't know she's already written All the Young Dudes. Also, during her break, Taylor was in a rather dark place. As we've heard from her other music and her talking about it in interviews, she felt extremely isolated and lonely. In that year, she'd been betrayed by one of her best friends. She had multiple people lying about her in the public eye. And someone she trusted for 15 years sold her music, her life's work, to someone she hated. She definitely would have understood the feelings of loneliness and betrayal that Remus was feeling after James and Lily's death. And writers love to explore their own trauma within their writing. Miss King Bean 89 said she wrote chapter 175, the chapter in which Remus is dealing with the aftermath of Sirius's betrayal, immediately after the first chapter. So she definitely was really excited to get to that part where she could get really into her feelings about this betrayal and this complete breakdown of your entire world, of Remus's entire world, which is kind of fucked, really. It's fucked up. Because I found it difficult to read those chapters because emotionally they were horrific, absolutely just the worst. I cried, like, before I went to bed, I had to stop reading, like, half an hour before and read some Heartstopper, the comic Heartstopper by Alice Oseman, so that I would stop crying enough to fall asleep. Anyway, All the Young Dudes is ridiculously sad. You kind of have to be in a dark place to write a Marauder's fanfiction because you know the ending. And the ending is fucking depressing. They all end up dead. And to study those characters and get to love them and then they just die, it's so fucking sad. Yeah, I mean, honestly, it's a terrible, terrible lockdown read because you just can't, you can't. That's all you can think about is James and Lily are dead, and Harry's got no parents, and Sirius is wrongly accused, and Remus thinks that his entire life has fallen down around him, and it has fallen down around him, but he doesn't know that Sirius was innocent, and it's just horrible. Just the fucking worst. Anyway. I say this also saying that it's just amazing and you'll love it. Like it's a good fan fiction. It's honestly like an epic, amazing book. It's 500,000 words. That's Order of the Phoenix is 200,000 words. This fan fiction is two times as long as The Order of the Phoenix. And it's so good that I read it in less than a week during exam season. But it's that good. And that's why it is emotionally devastating because it's that good. It gets you invested in the characters. Anyway, if we're going with the theory that Taylor Swift wrote this during her break, we can use all her subsequent albums to look for clues. And Taylor loves to put clues and Easter eggs in her work, especially her music videos. Take her music video for Willow, for example. First of all, we already have a link because the Whomping Willow, which was planted at the school for Lupin specifically, and can kind of work as a metaphor for him hiding his lycanthropy. In the video, Taylor exits a willow, just the way Remus would exit the willow alone during his first few years at Hogwarts. And Taylor looks longingly in the water at the reflection of her love, like Remus would. As he gets older, he realizes he has a crush on Sirius and he starts looking at him longingly. But he thinks that it could never happen. That's why he's away from Taylor in the water. He's looking at what he wants, but he can't have. He thinks he can't have. But Taylor jumps into the water to follow his reflection, similar to the way Remus didn't think that him and Sirius could ever be together, but he gets as close as possible to him anyway and even kisses him. So then Taylor stands in a glass box performing while people walk past. This is symbolic of when Remus came out and everyone was staring at him. But then Taylor's man is there in person and they're only separated by the glass, but the glass is a metaphor for how they are separated by Sirius's reluctancy to come out. The shot where they have their hands pressed to the glass shows that they are both trying to ignore the barrier between them of their internalized homophobia and be together. But Sirius just isn't ready to let go of everyone thinking he's a straight ladies' man. The line, "Life was a willow and it bent right to your wind," also works very well for Sirius. Though, like, he does have, like, hardships while in Hogwarts, for example, being abused by his parents and having to run away, he's still effortlessly charming and talented, and most of everything at Hogwarts goes his way. So then in the video, they all meet in the woods and start chanting and doing a dance, and this shows when the Order is together and they all leave school and start fighting the war. There are no physical barriers between Taylor and her man, representing Remus and Sirius's time in their London flat together as they fought. But Taylor walks away, much like Remus did when he was on his missions with the werewolves. And her man is sad, much like Sirius didn't trust Remus and thought he might have been the spy. Here we can look at the line, "Every bait and switch was a work of art," showing how at the end of the war, no one really trusted anyone, describing how they thought that their bait and switch of making people think Sirius was the secret keeper, but it actually being Peter, they thought that it was a work of art, but it ended in tragedy. In the end, Taylor leaves to go back to her house, where she gets to the end of the line. She thinks she's there alone, representing Remus's 12 years without Sirius. He was with Grant, but that doesn't fit into the metaphor, so we're just going to pretend that it doesn't exist while I just try and shove this metaphor into shape. But then Sirius escapes from Azkaban, and they rejoin the Order and get back together, and that's how it ends, with them back together, walking off into the night. Obviously, we know that they both die after that, but whatever. We could also look at Miss Americana and the Heartbreak Prince, which sounds a lot like Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince. Is this her continuation of All the Young Dudes? It ends just before the events of Order of the Phoenix. Is Miss Americana a continuation? Is Taylor telling the story of Tonks and Lupin? We're so sad we paint the town blue. Both Remus and Tonks are sad that Sirius died. Voted most likely to run away with you. Remus tries to run away with Harry to look for the Horcruxes. My team is losing, battered and bruising. I see the high fives between the bad guys. Reference to how the war is going. Voldy is gaining ground in Half-Blood Prince and even more in Deathly Hallows. And this may be a stretch, but high fives between bad guys could be a reference to how Wormtail cut off his hand and got the silver hand for Voldemort. Darling, I'm scared. They're in a war. Obviously they're scared. And I don't want you to go. I don't really want to fight because nobody's going to win. I just thought you should know. And I'll never let you go because I know this is a fight that someday we're going to win. It seems like both sides, neither is going to win the war because they both lost so much. But in the end, they know that goodness will win, so Remus and Tonks both continue to fight for what they believe in. And Remus decides to stay with Tonks instead of going off with Harry after Harry shouts at him. I'm just going to do some quick fire quotes. I want auroras and sad prose. This is fucking sad prose. All the Young Dudes is sad prose. I bathe in cliffside pools with my calamitous love and insurmountable grief. From the links. Remus has calamitous love. His love, he loved Sirius, but Sirius, he thought that Sirius had killed James and Lily. That is calamitous love if I've ever seen any. And Remus gets a drinking problem, spoilers, and that is his insurmountable grief. He can't surmount it without the drink. I thought I saw you at the bus stop. I didn't though. That's from The One. That's when Harry sees Sirius when he's about to fall over and call the night bus. You know, the greatest films of all times were never made. That's a reference to how we haven't got a Marauders TV show or movie yet. You make me so happy it turns back to sad. There's nothing I hate more than what I can't have. You are so gorgeous, it makes me so mad. From Gorgeous. That's about when Remus thought that Sirius was straight and would never love him. Obviously, he's not. I think I've seen this film before and I didn't like the ending. From Exile. Obviously, they all die. No one likes that ending. Do you miss the rogue who coaxed you into paradise and left you there? Will you forgive my soul when you're too wise to trust me and too old to care? They both went into paradise together, trusting each other in each other's love, and because of their mistrust, they now don't trust each other. Sirius, I feel like this is from Sirius's perspective when he's in Azkaban, will you forgive me for thinking it was you and putting us into this situation? Will Remus forgive me for thinking that Remus was the spy? Because of that, now I didn't tell Remus who the actual secret keeper was, and now I'm in Azkaban and James and Lily are dead. The entire song of Gold Rush, where I don't like that falling feels like flying till the bone crush, because Remus is just so in love with Sirius that it felt like flying. It felt amazing until, you know, the betrayal. I don't like a gold rush. It's how everything was beautiful and perfect and like a gold rush until the betrayal, until it ran out, the gold ran out and the trust ran out and Lily and James died. And it was fucking terrible. Obviously, there wasn't an actual betrayal there, but they both thought that there was a betrayal there. So I persist and resist the temptation to ask you, if one thing had been different, would everything be different today? That's also from The One. So if one thing had been different, if Sirius had been the secret keeper, if Remus had been the secret keeper, if Sirius had trusted Remus more, would everything be different? Would James and Lily still be alive? I'd sit with you in the trenches, give you my wild. Peace, from Peace. That's about how they went to war together. They sat in the trenches together. And Remus showed Sirius his wild, his werewolf side. He trusted him with that. As well, there's this line from in All the Young Dudes where Sirius says to Remus, Merlin, you don't stop until you've tasted blood, do you? It's like in This Is Me Trying when Taylor says, my words shoot to kill when I'm mad. I have a lot of regrets about that. How Remus really just is, in All the Young Dudes, he's really angry. And he will just say the most horrible, terrible things he can in order to not have to talk about his emotions. And afterwards, he regrets it. And especially after the whole just fucking James and Lily dying situation, he regrets it. I can go anywhere I want, just not home. Oh, fucking hell. My tears ricochet. Remus can't go back to Hogwarts, his home, until Harry's third year. And even when he does go there during third year, it's painful for him because it has all of the memories of everyone he loved and how much he's lost. Anyway, there are loads more, but, you know, we don't have time for that. I mean, we might have time for that. We could have time for that if you wanted, but if you like this, I'll do a part two where I find every single Taylor Swift lyric that works for Wolfstar. And I can do it. I spend a lot of time thinking about Wolfstar and listening to Taylor Swift. As well as this, Miss King Bean 89 has come out and said that she does not agree with JK Rowling's disgusting transphobic comments. And as we know from Taylor's You Need to Calm Down music video and the petition she wanted everyone to sign and the charity that she raised money for, GLAAD, Taylor loves trans people and raises their voices up, or tries to, she attempts to. Although I would say that hopefully that is maybe just like not much of a coincidence and more kind of just as like basic human decency, but you never know. I would hope that a lot of people would disagree with JK Rowling on this issue, but apparently not. Right, okay, we've gone through reasons that she is Taylor Swift. Now, let's have a look at reasons that it's not Taylor Swift who wrote this. First of all, Miss King Bean 89 has dismissed it, kind of, in a Tumblr post. She put, this is a direct quote. I not only love the thought that Taylor Swift, aka me, had time to write an epic Wolfstar fanfic, but that she also has incredibly niche views on the Terra Peep show. Yes, Taylor Swift has incredibly niche views on a lot of things. I'm not sure if she has anything on the Terra Peep show, but her boyfriend has a SoundCloud where he reads out poetry. So she's into like kind of weird niche stuff, you know? So is this really a denial or just a sidestep? Second, and this is the damning one for me. Miss King Bean 89 always gives a warning when a chapter is going to be sad. They'll say something like, "Think of your mental health before reading this chapter. If you're not up for it, it goes through things like abuse and things like that. So think of your mental health before reading this chapter." And Taylor Swift doesn't do that. Taylor will just drop albums, entire sad fucking albums, with no notice, with no thought of her fans' mental health. Or whether they can take another Taylor Swift album that day, she'll just boom, surprise album at midnight. This whole Miss King Bean 89 giving warnings, it doesn't feel very much like Taylor. Taylor is very much likes to get into sad things without warning. You'll be listening to a fun song like Me, and then next thing you know, fucking Marjorie is up next. And it's sad. No fucking warning. So it doesn't feel like Taylor, but it could all just be part of the persona that she's trying to project to make people think that it's not her. So, in conclusion, is Miss King Bean 89 Taylor Swift? In my opinion, yes. 100%. Also, tell me your thoughts on this fanfiction because I finished it yesterday. I finished reading it yesterday. And it was very emotional. It was very. Can you see the pain in my eyes? Can you see how much it's hurting me? Because I can feel it. I literally feel like I'm grieving for my friends James and Lily, who just died. And I feel like my one true love, soulmate, Sirius Black, betrayed me. But then I also feel like I got him back finally, and then he died a year later. Okay, bye.